Blackstone Publishing presents Sherlock Holmes vs. Cthulhu, The Adventure of the Neural Psychoses by Lois H. Gresh. This book is read by Dennis Kleinman. Dedicated with love to Ari, Rena, and Gabby. With gratitude to Arthur Conan Doyle and H.P. Lovecraft. Part 1. The E-Shockers of Whitechapel. 1. Dr. John Watson. December 1890, London. For 2 shillings apiece, Sherlock Holmes and I enjoyed a choppy yet pleasant ride down the Thames. My friend is not given to excursions for pleasure's sake alone, so when he suggested a trip to Woolwich upon the new paddle steamer, the Bell Crown, I had at first thought to refuse the invitation. I'd recently reunited with my wife and child after the terrifying events of the Deadly Dimensions, and was still beset by the dizzy spells and strained kaleidoscopic visions that had first begun to trouble me at that time. I was in no mood for more adventures. But Mary, thinking to lift my spirits, urged me to go. Not wanting to displease my wife or my friend, I relented. So it was that Holmes and I stood contemplating the docks of Wapping from the deck of the Bell Crown as it completed its return voyage through the Pool of London.
"You will no doubt remember, Watson," said Holmes, "that the warehouse in which we witnessed the Order of Dagon's meeting is upon that very shore. That is the place where Professor Fitzgerald released the snake-like monsters that attacked him and killed many of his congregation. I'd been glad to see some colour vanquish the death-like pallor that had gripped my friend since our battle with the inexplicable Deadly Dimensions, but now I wondered if it had been a mistake to venture onto the river so soon after our adventure. I remember, of course, Holmes. I'm glad that Fitzgerald is behind bars where he can do no more harm." Holmes smiled at me.
"I understand you, Doctor. You think I'm being morbid to dwell on these things. But I have brought us here for a purpose. Those creatures didn't simply slither off to die. I'm certain of it. I've not been able to see them from the banks, but here, out in the middle of the river, surely we will see something."
"Holmes," I reminded him gently, "we have twice seen the creatures vanish into thin air, into another realm, a different dimension.
That is one theory we must entertain, certainly, that the rational explanation is simply too advanced for us to fully understand. But we must eliminate the probable before we contemplate the improbable, Watson, and I'm not altogether convinced they vanished. A trick of the eye, perhaps."
The Thames surged past as we leaned on the rail of the Bell Crown. The craft was sleek as a bullet, pushing against the flow of the river. Nothing seemed amiss. Around us, families chattered and laughed, babies cried and gurgled, and everyone's cheeks were as flushed as Holmes's. My eye fell upon a baby not much older than my own Samuel, and I watched with pleasure as he giggled at the sensation of the fast-moving boat. Despite the 1878 crash of the Princess Alice, which had transported Londoners to and from beautiful gardens and parks, we had no reason to think the Bell Crown would meet a similar fate. What were the odds that another 900-ton iron-built ship would barrel down the river and kill us? The Bywell Castle, the giant craft that had split the Princess Alice in half and killed more than 650 passengers, had been an anomaly, representing a once-in-a-generation tragedy. Holmes interrupted my thoughts.
"The river is gaining momentum. Look at those waves, Watson."
I looked where he was pointing. Black water slammed the side of the Bell Crown, then thundered into the downstream current. Froth rode the crests of waves that would have been more at home in the ocean than on the Thames.
"It is choppy," I agreed, "but the weather is unpredictable at this time of year."
"This is more than choppy, and it's more than bad weather," Holmes argued. "The level of the water has risen."
"Well, that means the tide must be rising, surely," I declared.
Holmes shook his head.
"The tide should not be coming in yet, Watson. Did you not look at the tide tables when we boarded? And have you ever seen waves like this on the Thames?"
He turned his gaze toward the granite clouds through which weak light trickled down to the water.
"It has been overcast all day, but there's not been a drop of rain. I cannot think what could cause the river to swell this forcefully."
I could not continue the argument. He was quite right. The other passengers had noticed the sudden change in the waves, too. The woman holding the baby I'd been looking at gasped as the boat jolted us all, water surging in a cold spray onto the deck. She clasped her child to her chest and covered the infant's head with her hand. The man accompanying her took her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.